Good morning. Welcome to St Andrew's in the Grange here in Guernsey. We're now in the fourth phase of the release from lockdown due to the COVID-19 crisis. We've decided that thanks to the states we're going to be able to operate a mixed economy. We're still going to record pre-recorded service midweek, and we're allowed now to have a congregation on a Sunday morning, socially distanced, for just 30 people. So you're all very welcome, and thank you so much for joining us this morning. A call to worship. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Bring your songs and your stories, your struggles and your sacrifices. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. So let us worship God. Let us sing to his praise and to his glory. Our first hymn, hymn 192 in the church hymnary, All My Hope on God is Founded, verses 1, 3 and 5. Let us pray together. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. Only the man who loves his brother lives in the light. Father God, you make the light shine out of darkness. You make the sun rise on bad and good alike. You give us Christ, the world's light. We wake our minds to think of you. You live in light beyond all thought. Yet through Christ our Lord we know you, present here in love and power. We lift our hearts in praise to you. What is man that you should remember him, or mortal man that you should care for him? Yet through our Son Jesus Christ we know you care. In him you come not just to judge us, but to forgive and set us free. We know that is enough for us to face ourselves in your presence as honestly as we can, remembering how we have been cared for, how we have been too much sometimes wrapped up in ourselves, too hard on others, too quick to blame, how we have grumbled when we should have been thankful, have criticized when we should have tried to help, how we forget the rest of the world so long as we're all right ourselves. Lord Jesus, real light of the world, help us to admit such things now in your presence. Lord God, help us to accept forgiveness from you and from others. Take away our pride. Open our eyes to your glory. Help us to live in your light. And may each of us help and strengthen the other, that together we may come to know and love and follow our Lord Jesus, in whose words we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The first reading comes from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Peace and hope. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. We boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that sufferings produce perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation.
Our next hymn is the hymn 255, Father, hear the prayer we offer.
Second reading is taken from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 9, verse 35, to chapter 10, verse 8. The workers are few. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into this harvest field." Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely given. Here ends the second reading. May God add his blessing to these readings from his holy word.
My text for this address comes from the second reading we've just heard, Matthew chapter 10, and at the 7th verse. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. In a book called Seasons of the Word, the story is told about the head of a prominent family in Boston in the United States, who was retiring after a long and distinguished career in the publishing industry. And his family were wondering what they would give him as a gift to mark the occasion. After much discussion, they decided to present him with a history of the family, which had always been one of his lifetime interests. The family employed a well-known biographer to do the research and to write the story, and the book was to be printed as a limited edition. The biographer set about doing their work, which involved interviewing members of the family, consulting old records and letters, and starting to shape all the information into a readable story. The daughter of the family, whose idea the whole venture was, suddenly had a deep concern, which she felt she should share with the biographer. "I think we've got a problem," she said. "It's my great uncle George. He was the black sheep of the family, and no one ever talks about him. He died in the electric chair after he'd been found guilty of murder. If you're going to write an accurate history, you can't really miss him out. Perhaps you can just minimize the embarrassment." The biographer assured his worried client that he would take great care about writing about great Uncle George and would still write an accurate history of the family. When the book was finally printed, she was relieved to read, "Uncle George occupied a chair of applied electronics at a famous government institution. He was attached to his position by the strongest of ties, and his death came as a real shock." Today, ancestry and researching family trees is a popular pastime. As more digital archives are opened up and more personal and family information becomes available, the more we want to know about our ancestors. We all hope that somewhere in the family there is someone who was rich and famous, or who performed an heroic deed, or who went on a great voyage or expedition. But secretly, we're also looking for the black sheep of the family, the skeleton in the cupboard, the likable rogue, the uncle who no one ever mentions by name. Writing up family history can present problems for all of us and occasionally unearths one or two shocks and surprises. But if you think about it, what is interesting is that when Matthew and the other evangelists wrote their gospels, they display no interest whatsoever in biographical detail. The 12 apostles, the first members of the Christian family, appear in the Gospels as little more than a list of names. Apart from Judas, the only four who stand out amongst the 12 are the two sets of brothers, Peter and Andrew, James and John. Although each Gospel states that Jesus chose 12 apostles from among a larger group of disciples, we know little about them as individuals. There's even some variation in the four Gospels over the list of names. Perhaps the evangelists were deliberately avoiding what we today would call the cult of personality. The disciples and the apostles were chosen by Jesus to be his witnesses. It is as if Jesus' eyes had scanned the crowds who constantly followed him, searching, seeking, identifying and challenging the chosen few to come and be his fishers of men. He was searching for men and women of courage, loyalty, discipline, integrity, selfless commitment, and those who had an ultimate respect for others. Men and women who would lay down their lives for him, people who would rise up to the call where God is saying in Isaiah, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And they readily replied, "Here am I, God, send me." These experiences of Jesus walking the road of Palestine was unique in the history of the church. But they were important as apostles, for they pointed others to the person of Jesus Christ. This might explain why, although they were revered in the early church, there was no organized nostalgia or memory about them. They were all very ordinary people. They had no particular wealth, nor did they have any real academic background or special education. They had no special place or status in society. They were simply chosen from the people, for the people. They were hand-picked, not so much because they were extraordinary or had greater faith or belief than others. They were chosen because Jesus knew they could do ordinary things extraordinarily well. They were chosen not for who they were, but for what they could become with God's help and in God's name. You know, no one should ever think that they are not worthy or that they are of no use to God, for with God's help, all things are possible. There's no hard sell. There's no bonus being paid. There's no guarantee of a safe passage. Only the sure and certain knowledge that whatever we do in God's name, we will never be alone, nor should we ever be afraid, not even when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. In every generation, the church moves forward in the life of faith, where each follower and believer must give birth to its own apostles. The apostles of every age must be as modest as the apostles of the first age. Their mission and task was to point people to the living Lord. These were people who knew that the kingdom of heaven had come here. And when we look closer at the 12 disciples, they were a complete mixture of people, backgrounds, and experiences. These were men from many different spheres of life and belief, were the very foundation stones on which the church was built. It was on the stuff of common men and women that the Church of Christ is founded. We are all called to holiness. We are all called to follow Jesus. We are all called to make Jesus known to all mankind. Like the chosen people of Israel, we are counted as members of the kingdom of God. We cannot spend our time in nostalgia, looking back to days when Jesus walked the roads of Palestine with the 12. We must minister to our own time, taking responsibility for our own mission. That is a matter for all of us. The call to serve God in our day takes us onwards and upwards, not to go backwards or in reverse. It is a call to the future. That doesn't mean that we cannot look back on our own Christian church and history, in the course of which we will bump into a legion of great Uncle Georges. Rather, it means that we refuse to be fixated by what has been. Our responsibility is to serve God today and tomorrow. As you go out, proclaim this message: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, our Heavenly Father, for the world that you have made, for the wonder and beauty and wealth. We give thanks for the powers you have given to us to enjoy the world in which you have made. We give you thanks, Heavenly Father, that you call people in every day and in every age to come and to be near you and to be your disciples. Lord, hear us as we pray for your world. A world that is broken. A world where there is sometimes cruelty between man and man. For the difficulties that governments and those in positions of authority have to deal with. We remember that Christ carried the sorrows of all, and we believe that your Spirit strives in all men and women for truth and justice. We pray for our country and our people. We pray for all those who live here in the bailiwick of Guernsey. We give thanks for your ministers, for those who have made decisions that have brought the states into a position we're now freeing up from lockdown. We pray for Elizabeth, our Queen, and all the members of the Royal House. May we not rest till there is a place of dignity and freedom in our land, for young and old, for weak and strong. We give you thanks for this, our church, for all who attend today and who attended in the past and who will attend in the future here at St Andrew's in the Grange. We pray for the Church of Scotland and all the churches across the bailiwick. We give you thanks, Heavenly Father, for those who have been in the front line, our doctors and nurses, our healthcare workers and paramedics, those who have reached out the hand of friendship to those who are in need. We remember those who have died. Eternal Father, we give thanks for all those who have worshipped here in times past and have shown the love of Christ in their generation. Especially we give you thanks for those dear to ourselves. Give us the same loyalty and courage in our day, and keep us at one with them in spirit. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for our church. Accept, O Lord, these our prayers, those spoken and those unspoken, for we offer them in and through the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Friends, thank you for joining us this morning. Thank you for joining us online and here in the church. We're going to have to continue this system for the next couple of weeks. We are going to have to continue our rota, and if you would like to come to church and be physically with us at the service, we've only got 30 places, so please do contact Hilary, and if you make contact them, we will guarantee you a seat at this service. But we've been grateful that you've been able to join us this week and throughout this time of the global pandemic. Our final hymn is the hymn 533, Will You Come and Follow Me, verses 1, 4 and 5. And all those whom you love, this day and always.